Testing, testing, testing. 1, 2, 3, 4. Testing, 1, 2, 3, 4. This is a test of the dual Califone 1500 AV tape recorders. We're looking at the 1500 AV BL, which is blueberry, and the 1500 AV ST, which is strawberry. Now, if everything is going correctly, these two machines should be speaking at the same time, and there should be no problems with speed fluctuations. This is the end of the test. Welcome to A Tale of Two Tape Recorders, which I would subtitle The Story of Nature versus Nurture, because one of these machines was seriously abused while the other was in pristine condition. Stay tuned for the video. Now, in the introduction, I said that this is an illustration of nature versus nurture. It was the best of times, it was the worst of times. For one of these machines, that's exactly true. It was the best of times. For one of these machines, it was the worst of times. Both machines came from eBay. Both were offered at the same price. But one was marked for parts only, does not work, and the other was marked works great, almost brand new. Can you guess which one was which? This blueberry tape recorder, which came with a set of blueberry headphones, you have to have your blueberry headphones, was cosmetically almost perfect. Mechanically almost perfect, electrically almost perfect. Didn't need very much work at all, just a little bit of oil for the motor, a little bit of cleaning of the belts and the heads, good to go. This machine came DOA, dead on arrival. The pause control had been jammed in the down position, and the fast forward and the rewind didn't work, the play didn't work properly, the door was stuck and wouldn't open, their belts had failed, and the record play switch was having problems. This was a completely dead machine when I got it. Of course, now it's good. So, the best of times, the worst of times, and now, thanks to ClydeSight, the best of times. These were educational machines meant for schools and classroom use. They have a limited frequency response, 100 to 10,000 cycles per second, really made for voice operation, although they're very good and can play music because the wow and flutter rating is only 0.3%, so they're good for music. They play pre-recorded tapes very, very well, and this is ideal for classroom use where there's going to be a lot of use. Possibly some abuse, as this poor thing suffered. And people can borrow them, and it's easy to use. The controls are very clearly marked on both labels. And so they're very ideal machines for their purpose. We have a record button here, which automatically pushes down the play button that's next to it. And, of course, obviously, this is the play button. We have a rewind, which is not a cue rewind, it's just a rewind. We have a fast forward, which is not a cue fast forward, it's just a fast forward. We have a stop and eject, you can see that. And we have an actual mechanical pause control. And they are, of course, labeled up here on the top. We have a three-digit counter up here, and it's marked as two times counter. I've never understood what two times counter means. I've looked it up on the internet, and the closest thing I could find was it says 2 times ANSI, A-N-S-I, which is a standard, the Standard Institute. But what that means, I don't know. As you can see here, the door has been heavily scratched and suffered quite a bit of damage. This door, of course, is pristine. Then back here, believe it or not, is where you have your built-in microphone on both of the machines. Normally on a consumer tape recorder, you'll see the microphone up here, but Califone put them in the back for some reason. Now let's take a look at the side. And on the side here, we see a volume control, a mic and remote input for any, you know, dual plug microphone that has separate dual plugs because of the spacing. Then there is a it says HP/EXTSPKR, and that's a quarter inch jack for headphones, that's what HP stands for, or external speaker. When the headphones are plugged in here or the speaker, the internal speaker is silenced. Then this says HP, which is headphone. When a headphone is plugged in here, the external speaker continues to sound. You can see that you can see through the case, and if we look at the back of it, we see it's got embossing here, and this is the battery compartment, which holds four C-size batteries. It's a 6-volt system, and it has this strap attached to it so you don't lose the cover. You remember how people will lose battery covers like crazy. And it has an AC line that goes to a transformer. We can see it right there. So we don't need a brick, what I call a brick. Now if we look here, here's the capstan, and it is a Chinese mechanism because if we look at the label here, it says made in China. And this is a standard Chinese mechanism. It's what I call the silver dollar mechanism because it has this metal flywheel, and then there's a plastic pulley attached to it. So this is a standard mechanism, of course, and here's your amplifier. And you might be able to see this here is where the record play switch is attached, and then this is the IC chip that controls a lot of the amplifier functions. Now the sound is very good quality. I don't know if it's AC or DC bias. It sounds like AC bias. This machine you would think is almost exactly the same, and it is almost exactly the same. A little bit harder to see through the plastic, but the same components seem to be there. And again, this is of course the 6-volt system. Now here we have a different type of Chinese mechanism. This is a plastic flywheel, and I just simply painted the rim of it silver because I wanted to be able to see it spinning. I mean, that's half the fun of having a translucent case. But you notice that it's harder to see through the case, the blue case, than it is to see through the red case. Not sure why that is, but anyway, so the blue case is not quite as much fun as the red case is. Anyway, we can see also the same amplifier structure with the record play switch and then the IC here. So the amplifier is basically the same thing. Now, one of the things you'll see here, which I noticed when I looked at the listing, it looks like this is an LED, a square LED. Actually, it's not. It's a little yellow rubber pad, and it shows sort of green through the blue here. And if we look at it through the red, it's sort of orangey looking because it's, again, a yellow rubber pad for shock absorption. Both of these machines have speed controls on the motor. The motor is located right here, but you have to puncture this label to get into the speed control, and I'm not willing to do that. And so you can see a little bit better here, you can see the motor a little bit better here, and of course you would have to puncture through to get to the speed control. So that's a basic tour of the machine. What we're going to do now is we're going to take a look at this machine in detail. We're going to look at the inside of it, how it was built, how it works, and what the repair work that I had to do on it was. And by looking at that, we see basically what's going on here. When dealing with a tape recorder and running into problems that you have, like parts are not moving properly, you've got rewind that doesn't work, fast forward that doesn't work, and so on. The most common response or solution that people recommend is change out the belts. And that drives me crazy because the belts are one aspect of a very complicated process. This is a very complicated little mechanism. This is a Chinese mechanism, obviously, from the inside of this tape recorder. And this machine had a problem with the rewind and the fast forward and the play, which just simply wasn't working properly. It was dragging, and I couldn't figure out why it was dragging. So, of course, I followed the same advice that most people would follow, and I changed out the belts. And it was still dragging, and I couldn't figure out what was causing that. So I had to get into the inside of the upper part of the mechanism, which is not easy on this particular machine. And I found out that this drive wheel here, which is the friction clutch mechanism for the take-up, had a problem. What happens a lot with the cassette machines, especially the modern cassette machines, is that the upper part, which is the spindle, which actually grabs the tape, is pressure fit onto an axle, which is part of a lower gear that you can't see here. I'm pointing to it underneath. And that is, between the two of them, there's a piece of felt and there's a spring. Well, over time, this plastic, because of aging and it, you know, flexing and expansion and contraction and so on, it starts to let go. And when it starts to let go, the spring continues to push down on the system, forcing it tighter and tighter and tighter between the clamp that holds the whole thing into the axle and the bottom plate. As a result, this gets stiffer and stiffer and stiffer. So what I had to do was I had to get this out. Now, getting this out is a trick, because over here we could see the mechanism for the auto shut off. It doesn't move when it's in the off position, but that's the trigger, and we've seen this in a lot of tape recorders. The trigger traveled over here to a second piece, which moves in and engages a tab on here on the take-up table. And when the trigger pushes the tab, the system, so that it's going to engage the tab, as this turns, it kicks the tab over, causing it to trip the stop mechanism. I had to take that part out, and I had to ruin it to get it out because of the way it was put in. I don't like these auto-stop mechanisms anyway, as these tend to cause drag on the tape. So I had to sacrifice that. And then I had to work with a screwdriver very carefully underneath the table while holding my finger over the top here like that, because there is a tiny, tiny, tiny plastic washer that clamps the axle. And when I popped the thing up, I got the washer out, this whole mechanism tried to fly apart. And the reason it tried to fly apart was because the pressure fit between this spindle lock for the tape and the lower plate, the pressure fit just wasn't pressure fitting anymore. Well, what's the solution to that? It's simple. You take it apart, you clean it really, really well, and then you put a dab of super glue on the top part of the pressure fit and reassemble it, holding it down, keeping it locked down, because this spindle does not move, neither does this spindle. In the old cassettes, the spindles would move up and down on springs to engage the tape, but nowadays they don't do that because usually the tape will just accommodate it and just snap into the slots properly anyway. So that's what had to be done. It was a complicated process and very, very delicate work, because this, especially this washer, is so tiny. And you need almost a special round tool to put the washer back in once you get it out. But everything is working now, and I just wanted to point out, don't fall for the line that belts are the only thing you need to replace on a tape recorder when it doesn't work. That's just the beginning of the problem. Now, let's take a look at just a couple other things right here while we have this part of the machine open. And we can see here is the speed control for the machine. And that actually engages another part here. If the label behind here that I'm pointing to, this little hole, is lifted off, you can get through this hole into the motor speed control, which is over here, obviously. Again, you're going to need the plastic tool to make the adjustment, because if you use a metal tool, it'll short the system. And that's not going to let you adjust the speed control. Looking over here, just as long as we have this open, here's the three-digit tape counter and the little belt that runs it. And this belt is in okay shape for right now. It doesn't need to be changed. and we can see the push buttons here that activate all of the features, and here's the erase head and the record play head. We can see that this machine uses the silver dollar capstan, what I call it. There's actually a little metal plate here and a plastic pulley. Obviously a single belt to the motor back here, and then there's a belt to the gear shifter, which is over here, and this has a friction clutch mechanism in it. Now on these machines that use this type of assembly, sometimes the pressure between the back plate and the friction clutch assembly loosens because the plastic gets loose and doesn't hold on to the stem properly. Fortunately, this one is in good condition. When they do get loose, what I do is I just simply put them down with a bit of super glue. These machines are so common that I'm used to working on a lot of them. Now here we see the fingers for the different controls. I'll give you an example of how that works. I'm going to have to lift it up a little bit, and we'll put it into rewind or fast forward. It's upside down. I can't remember which is which, but you can see that it's obviously turning. And then here is the play, and then here's stop and eject, which is now push the lid open, and this is the pause control here. Now I'm going to zoom in because I want to show you what happened here. Attention! We interrupt this explanation with a demonstration. I'm going to use this wonderful Sony dynamic microphone, the F98, which is low impedance, doesn't give the actual value, and I'm going to use this to demonstrate how this records not using the internal mic but using the plug-in. So here we go. As with any cassette recorder, it's simple enough. I'll put the pause control, set the counter, put down the record button, and here we go. Testing, 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 testing 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. This is a test of the Califone cassette recorder 1500AV-BL, otherwise known as Blueberry. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10. Testing for sibilance. She sells seashells by the seashore. This is the end of the test. That's all we have to do. Now we will rewind. Back to zero. And let's hear how that plays. Testing, 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 testing 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. This is a test of the Califone cassette recorder 1500AV-BL, otherwise known as Blueberry. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10. Testing for sibilance. She sells seashells by the seashore. This is the end of the test. This concludes the interruption of the explanation with a demonstration. We now return you to your regularly scheduled explanation. What I'm trying to point out here is that there is a piece of plastic here, and that's what actually pushes against this piece. But there is a piece of plastic behind it also. And what had happened with this machine was this screw here, which is a mounting screw, the post underneath it cracked and fell off the case. So this whole corner lifted up. When that lifted up, somebody pressed the pause control, pushing the key back so that it was caught behind this plate right here. And as a result, you couldn't turn the pause on and off. You couldn't do anything with the tape recorder because it was continuously jammed. So I had to get everything loose and then realign everything, and I glued the post back down. How that post broke, I don't know, but that was a problem that I had to fix. And there is a post in the back, which you see has no screw, and the reason is the post itself completely shattered, and I couldn't glue it back together. There was nothing I could do. But that corner is still covered because there's a screw here for the motor, and the motor plate is screwed to here, so it's effectively one piece of metal. The rest of the machine had some other minor problems with it. Most important was the amplifier board here. The record play switch, and we can see the solder connections for it located here, was filthy, so it couldn't record. I got in there with some deoxit, and that took care of it. There's no problem whatsoever now, so it's working just fine. So these are the things that you deal with an old tape recorder. The volume control was a little scratchy, but it's clean now, so it's better. Now, one other thing that I had to fix was the door. Now, to show how that works, I have to open the door. And I'm not sure how clear this is going to be, so I'm going to shine the light on it again. If you can see, there's a metal spring here, and there's a hole, and that spring goes into the hole. Now, that's like a safety pin. It looks like a safety pin. So the other end of it goes into a hole right here inside the case. I had to create that spring because the original spring was designed to lean against the post right here that had shattered. So that spring couldn't use that post because it shattered, so the spring was useless. I had to replace it entirely. The tape recorder is back together. It has a pull-out handle in the front made of plastic, and as you can see in the back here, the wire comes directly out of the back, just like on the Blueberry model. And the door here, you can see, is pretty scratched up. This received some pretty bad damage. Now, we can look at it and say, oh, it's ruined, it'll never be any good. Or we can say, this is scars from the journey of life. Or we can go science fiction and say, this came from the spaceship Nostromo and was attacked by alien. Any fantasy will do. Attention, attention. We interrupt this explanation for another demonstration. We discovered that the Strawberry tape recorder was very jealous of the Blueberry tape recorder because it didn't get a demonstration. So in fairness, we have to allow this machine to be demonstrated just as well as the other one. Again, we use our Sony microphone. We put pause in place, press zero, set the recording. And here we go. Testing, 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 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. Testing the cassette recorder, 1500AV-ST, otherwise known as Strawberry, for recording purposes. Testing, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10. Now, testing for sibilance. She sells seashells by the seashore. This is the end of the test. We push stop, remove the microphone, then we rewind, back to zero, play. Testing, 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 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. Testing the cassette recorder, 1500AV-ST, otherwise known as Strawberry. For recording purposes, testing 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10. Now, testing for sibilance. She sells seashells by the seashore. This is the end of the test. So there we have it. The sound is almost identical. There obviously are slight differences between the two machines because they have slight differences of experience. This was very heavily abused. This one was almost fresh, as if it came from the package. It still has some of its labels even. This concludes the interruption of your explanation with a second demonstration. We now return you to your regularly scheduled explanation. Well, ClydeSight is really about history. That's what the whole YouTube channel is dealing with, the history of tape recorders, both reel-to-reel and cassette. Mostly from the 1960s and 70s, although I have machines going back to 1952, and I have machines all the way up to 2005 or 6. These machines actually date from around 2007. Now, why is this important? Well, It's important for historical reasons because these machines appeared or were manufactured at a very specific time in history for a very specific reason. Or this is what my theory is anyway. And let's follow it up a little bit. Okay, first of all, what do we know about the Califone company? While they're certainly still in business, they have a reputation for making good quality audio-video materials for the educational marketplace. They're not the only people who do this, but they have established themselves as a leader in the field. And as you can see when you go to their website, they have quite a few products to help people in the educational marketplace instruct younger people and to help teach. And that's what these machines were all designed for. Of course, they're not using that many cassette recorders. They're not that many available anymore because we're moving towards the digital age. Obviously, MP3 and CD players and so on are taking over, although cassettes are beginning to make a bit of a comeback. But for a while there, schools and institutions had cassette libraries that they used for language learning, for audiobooks and so on, which were helpful to young people or students who were trying to learn and needed the benefit of this technology. Now, why in the world was this important that it came in these colors? Well, partially it's because of entertainment value, but it was also, I think, because of a fad that got started by a completely different company. Can you think of what that company might be? Let's go back to 1998 and what companies were producing technology and what came up with a groundbreaking, totally groundbreaking machine that nobody had seen the likes of which before. Pause the video if you want to think about it and then come back. The company that I'm thinking of that was so groundbreaking is still a groundbreaking company. You recognize the name immediately, Apple Computer. Now, why Apple Computer? Because in 1998, they came out with a new kind of computer called the iMac G3. And this was what became popularly known as the gumdrop computer. It was the first all-in-one computer, and it took the market by storm because it had a design that, as we've come to think of Apple, they always come up with something innovative and amazing, and this was an amazing machine. One of the things they did was, besides designing a gumdrop-shaped computer, I mean, who would think of that? Instead, they broke out of the box completely, literally. And they created this gumdrop-shaped computer, but they did something else with it. They put it in a translucent case. So the most popular version was in a type of blue case like this called Bondi Blue. And that sold like gangbusters. But Apple didn't stop there. They also made blueberry, this color. They made strawberry this color, or I think they called it ruby red. They had one called tangerine, which is orange. They had one green, which was called lime. And they had one that was translucent white, which they called snow. This took the technology world by storm. I mean, it was so popular. They sold a lot of machines. And of course, naturally, nothing succeeds like success, so all the other technological innovators decided to copy Apple. I mean, Apple set the standard. So soon you started to see computer peripherals that were coming in colors like blueberry, strawberry, tangerine, and so on. I got a MIDI interface for my computer in the year 2000, and I had a choice of 14 colors for a MIDI interface that you don't even look at. This is how popular this whole idea had become. So at the time, these types of machines were very popular because of the coloring. And this in America was a big change because prior to Apple introducing their computers, all computers were in these beige boxes. They didn't look like much of anything, but we see them breaking out, breaking the mold, and the other technology companies followed suit. Well, so did Califone. They saw the writing on the wall and they decided to follow suit. And that's why they put these machines out, I think, in these colors. I don't know how popular they were, but I've seen the blue machines on eBay quite often. Not so much the strawberry ones, but these are still being sold brand new. But they're not sold brand new through the Califone website. You'll find them on Amazon and certain photo places, which for some reason are selling tape recorders, and so on. So the reason this is historically important is because it's an example of what one technological leader did that influenced a whole movement among other technological leaders. Now, some companies ignored it completely. For example, Aiki, which is a competitor of Califone, everything that they did came out in plain old gray. They weren't interested in the colors, they just wanted to paint the machines so that they worked. I think that that is historically significant about design and how design can influence other people and other designs that come out. As far as the history of the tape recorder goes, another thing that I think is interesting is that Califone, if you go to their website, they don't mention these machines at all. They mention the 1500 AV, but they do not mention these colored machines. Almost as if they're embarrassed by it, and I don't think that they should be embarrassed by it. This is a clever idea. Now the headphones, which you can see here, Califone does discuss these headphones on their website. They're good quality headphones. I'm not going to wear them because, as you can see, the band is narrow. It's made for a child-sized skull, and my skull is a bit larger than that, so I don't want to strain the band because it's just plastic. And but I have tried them on, though, and they're quite comfortable, and they have very good sound. But these normally came in a white color, but they started making these in blue after this machine came out, from what I can see. I think this came out in 2005. The headphones came out in 2007. Thank you for watching the video, YouTube. I hope that this helped you and entertained you. And if you have any comments or suggestions, based on what you've seen in the video, please feel free to make a comment. Be sure and like the video and put comments, because YouTube uses that to let other people know that this video is available to help them learn about the history of these products. Thank you so much. Bye-bye, YouTube.